A year into the Great War, if not sooner, all reasonable people were clear that it was a major disaster, a major failure, the horrors of which no one except a few very far-sighted individuals really foresaw. But given this, the next question, of course, was what kind of failure? And it is this question we are still concerned with today. Was the outbreak of war in August of 1914 a failure of diplomacy, the view expressed most famously in Lloyd George's dictum that the nation slithered over the brink into the boiling cauldron of war? Or was it something quite different, a failure of foresight on the part of political and military elites, in particular German and Austrian ones, who went to war open-eyed but miscalculated disastrously both the immediate and the more remote consequences? It is this latter view expressed with great force by Fritz Fischer, a German historian, in the 60s, that captured the imaginations and convinced people not merely of the historical profession but also more generally. And Fischer was aided in this by a brilliant group of then young German historians, many of which his disciples and followers. And for almost half a century, the Fischer view viewed not uncontested, but certainly it was dominant, as I said, both among the profession and more generally. It was contested recently in various ways by people calling for what Samuel Williamson Jr., a famous historian of Austro-Hungary, called the end of the German paradigm. And no one has perhaps expressed this revisionist view more forcefully in a way that captured, one might also say, the popular imagination, the Professor Christopher Clark, who is with us today. So I thought we should start our panel with a pair of statements by first Professor Harmut Pogge von Strandmann, who is a professor of modern history at Oxford University, but who initially was a doctoral student and assistant to Fritz Fischer, and whose distinguished career includes many contributions to the overall debate about the Fischer thesis. I mentioned in particular a brilliant restatement of the Fischer thesis made by Professor von Strandmann in 1888 in a volume he co-edited called The Coming of the First World War. More recently, Professor von Strandmann was concerned with the question of German colonialism in Africa and published a substantial volume based on New York Cavell research in 2009. But from the narrowly Serbian point of view, Professor von Strandmann has a connection to Serbia of a particular kind. A relation of his, Vasily Strandmann, was Russian charge d'affaires in Belgrade just before the First World War, and his book was translated fairly recently, a book of memories called Balkan Memories. Professor Christopher Clark hardly needs an introduction in Belgrade today. His views have been discussed widely, both by Serbian historians and by the press generally. But let me just say that he is also famous for two books concerned with Germany, one called Iron Kingdom, a history of Prussia, called The Rise and Downfall of Prussia, 1600 to 1947, and the noted biography of Kaiser Wilhelm II. History, of course, is always concerned with specifics, specific countries, specific facts, actions and decisions. And we are fortunate, indeed honored, to have with us today both Professor von Schadow and Professor Clark, and also Professor Lieven, one of the foremost historians of Russia, in particular Imperial Russia, living and writing today. I'll just mention some of his fundamental publications that have influenced the field extensively. First of all, his early book on Russia and the origins of the First World War. Then what is almost a companion volume to it called Russia's Rulers Under the Old Regime. But then also, more recently, two very important books. One, a biography of the last Tsar Nicholas II, and an even more wide-ranging book called Empire, the Russian Empire and its Rivals, that goes in for brilliant comparisons of Imperial Russia with other empires. And finally, any discussion of the beginnings of the First World War would be incomplete without Serbia. And we are fortunate to have with us today Dr. Vojislav Pavlović of the Institute of Balkan Studies in Belgrade, who devoted his doctorate to a particular aspect of the First World War, the relations between Serbia and France, who is also a specialist on the Second World War and who's been concerned recently with fundamental archival research into the biography of Josip Broz Tito, the statesman or dictator, whatever you like to call him, who marked the second part of the 20th century, both in Serbia and in former Yugoslavia. So I would like to ask Professor von Strandmann to speak first.
Easier solution. Well, thank you very much for a very kind introduction, and I should try something in Serbian, something like Dobar Daniel, Dobro Došli. Anyhow, what Fritz Fischer's first book dealt most, what all the chapters were about, were war aims. Not the beginning of the war. It was a chapter he wrote reluctantly with lots of help, and that wasn't his main part of the book. So I'm going to talk a little bit about war aims again from early on, and we tried to find out whether there were any war aims before the outbreak of the war, because whether then we could establish any causal links between war aims and intention to war. And I won't give you a definite answer, but I will show you what I think is possible. So the interesting thing is that the underpinning of war aims was a widespread belief in Germany that the Reich fought a defensive war against a world of enemies. The expected eventual victory was seen as a justification for imposing German power as a dominating fork factor in European politics. The redrawn European map was to reflect German ambitions. The subsequent lengthy and controversial public debate about Fischer's book focused on three areas. First of all, the German causes for the Europe-wide conflict attracted most of the attention. Secondly, the domestic politics of the war were widely discussed, but failed to figure as prominently. And thirdly, the aspect of continuity between First and Second World War stoked the heat of the public debate. One particular aspect of Fischer's concentrated work is the so-called September program of 9th September 1914. in which the German Chancellor Bethmann Hollweg formulated its first catalogue of German war aims. The program was drawn up at the peak of the Battle of the Marne, when German victory was anticipated but didn't materialize. Practically, Germany, I would argue, lost the war because it didn't win the Battle of the Marne. The September program was a result of several discussions members of the government had among themselves and with important politicians and leading members of the business world, so far underestimated in the debate. The circle of those involved in these discussions was rather large and indicated the willingness of the government to listen to various proposals. As a result of these deliberations, it should be possible to ask whether the proposals reflect some German pre-war ambitions and policies. So I would like to reopen this debate again. Although there is no pre-war September program, there are a number of pre-war plans which Germany wanted to realize. In addition, a number of themes immediately after the outbreak of the war in early August need to be taken into account as well. So these aims and considerations were dependent on victorious military actions against France and Russia before the two powers had become militarily so strong that Germany had little chance of defeating them. Thus, the war was regarded as a means to an offensive end, and not just purely as a defensive action, as the official policy would have it. And in the German mind, Germany fought a defensive war in the First World War when troops were in Belgium, in Russia, in Italy, in Eastern France, etc. But the same attitude you will find in Germany in the Second World War, when Germans, even when they were in Stalingrad or on the Atlantic coast in Western France, thought they're fighting a defensive war. The next aim was to achieve military victory as soon as possible. Anticipating victory aims for the expected peace negotiations had to be worked out. The general staff had to plan for military victory, but there was no equivalent among the civilian departments, especially designated for working out peace conditions, till later the Home Office was involved. But the discussion in the public revealed a consensus aiming at expanding Germany's power by peaceful means, and if that did not yield enough, ultimately by war. The direction of these aims was in Eastern Europe and overseas. The width of these deliberations in the public are reflecting in talks members of the government had with private citizens. One such an account is well known. It's Walter Rathenau's conversation with the German Chancellor in the summer of 1912, in which the industrialists suggested political goals, the establishment of a customs union for Central Europe, the creation of a German-dominated Middle Africa, and a strengthening of Germany's influence in the Middle East. All three expansionist goals appear again later in the war aims program in September in modified form. Among the non-government organizations, it was a Pan-German League, a radical group on the extreme right, which drafted a war aims program in July 1914 because it believed in the inevitability of the war, that is, on the 17th of July. It suggested settlement schemes for German farmers in Eastern Europe as colonizers and protectors of the forthcoming extended German boundaries. The fact that similar official war aims were drawn up later in the first euphoric phase of the war indicated that the thinking of the pan-German leadership was not so different from other unofficial but also official circles. In early August, the German government advocated the creation of semi-independent states in Western Russia in order to push the Tsarist state further eastwards and gain more space for German economic and military aspirations as well as settlements. Yet one of these most important volumes, which was discussed in military circles, was to establish Germany as a preeminent military power. The military had thought that this position which Germany had gained after the victory over France in 1871 was going to be lost. And so therefore, if you can re-establish that military predominance, then everything would follow from that. And military predominance was for the military much more important than for the politicians, because the military feared that the Allies might become too strong and therefore German military predominance would not be guaranteed. So it was really an attempt to say we need really Germany to be back in the position of 1871 and late 70s, and for that reason we need to fight a war. Now, the military had asked for this in the 1870s, 1880s, 1890s. So each time the military had asked that such a war would be conducted. But it was again in 1914 that they pressed for it. Now, a lot of people have made this case about Russian armaments being too strong for Germany to crush Russia as well as France by 1917. The interesting thing about this is that on the Russian side, there's no indication that Russia discussed a delay of its war actions and mobilization till 1917 in order to attack with a supremacy Germany and Austria. That's not the case. So I'm much more of the opinion that Moltke and Bethmann-Hollweg used the Russian threat as a construct to get people behind their expensive war aims and to have a war earlier than was perhaps wished for by other people. So it was felt that Germany's safety demanded reassertion of its hegemonial position. German society felt superior to France economically, militarily, and psychologically. Nevertheless, it was felt that the French Entente with Britain and the Franco-Russian alliance had strengthened the French position so that the conflict looked even more unavoidable than in the late 19th century. As one would expect, the German General Staff in Berlin repeatedly referred to the need for war to guarantee national security, not an unknown argument among the Americans, even with the Iraq War. After the military bills of 1912 and 13, the General Staff was convinced that the moment for a victorious war looked good, a situation which was not guaranteed with certainty in later years. This was not a defensive argument, as I've pointed out, because if German victory was going to be established sooner rather than later, then the German predominance would follow. The rationale behind the push for war was not used to win over the public. The threat to military superiority as a reason for war, as a military argument, which had been used in all international crises. All the arguments for army increases suggest that Germany could be put on the defensive if it did not increase its military strength and seize the earliest opportunity for an aggressive campaign in the West. The belief in the superiority of the German armed forces were based on the belief that the army was better organized, better trained, better equipped, and had a greater speed of mobilization than the Russian and French armies. For that reason, you didn't need to prepare all this all that much. Most of the work of the General Staff was working out timetables. I've seen General Staff timetables which went through Berlin in a sophisticated way and top secret documents at nighttime, trains moving from one station to another. And at one stage, it was visited by the chief of staff, the war minister, and the local supreme commander to see a little bypass by the railway to be constructed. But this couldn't be done public because this was secret and would not be discussed by the Reichstag. So the military worked really on detailed plans for speedy mobilization. And if you look at the mobilization of Germany, it was quite a feat of technology in 1914 to do it as quickly as that. The argument used to come back by Moltke and Bethmann that by 1917 Germany would have lost its advantageous position because of rising military strength and therefore it needed to assert its continental hegemony. The reference to 1917 looks like a construct because nobody knew what the international situation would be like in that year, a point which was even made by the German ambassador in London. So far, no sources have been mentioned on the Russian side that its policies in 1914 should be more cautious because by 1917 its military strength would have grown massively. This is, of course, an argument which Lieven and Schimmelpfennig can use, and for Schimmelpfennig it was quite clear in his latest piece of an article that the Russian side was worried about Germany's hegemonial position. In any case, the German military and political leaders were determined to exploit the favorable opportunities the July crisis offered to launch either victorious war or, and I quote here, if the war does not come, we will still have the prospect of maneuvering the Entente apart, which is not a defensive aim. That's mentioned in the Rietzler diaries. Thus, the preservation of the international status quo was not to satisfy the German political leadership. One of the early war aims was discussed in Berlin when the special Austrian envoy, Count Hoyos, came to Berlin. The Austrian ambassador handed a letter of the Austrian Emperor Franz Joseph to William II, in which he appealed to the German Kaiser to help Austria to reduce and isolate Serbia and eliminate her forthwith as a political power factor in the Balkans. A reconciliation with Serbia was no longer possible. And if a war against Serbia was regarded necessary, then William would regret it if the present favorable conditions were not used by Austria. So that's the first one we have before the outbreak of the war. A later example of early German aims can be found in the Kaiser's outburst against Britain on 30th of July, before the war breaks out. In it, Wilhelm fulminated against Britain's position and believed that all our consuls in Turkey and India, agents and other people, should revolutionize the entire Muslim world to fierce rebellion against this hated, lying, conscienceless nation of shopkeepers. For if we are bled to death, England should at least lose India. A day earlier, Bethmann Hollweg met the British ambassador and was able to state that provided that Belgium did not take sides against Germany, her integrity would be respected after the conclusion of the war. In the British office, Foreign Office, it was noted that Germany practically admits the intention to violate Belgian neutrality. It's amazing that it was done that early. The Chancellor also added that provided Britain stayed neutral, Germany aimed at no territorial acquisitions at the expense of France. But it would not be possible for him to give such assurance about the French colonies. So what Germany wanted was not only the Belgian Congo, but quite a chunk of the French colonies. Bethmann's thoughts were then contingent on British neutrality. If that was not forthcoming, Germany's aims would probably be less moderate. In the East, certain initiatives predate the outbreak of hostilities. On 31st of July, William II gave Graf Hutten-Chapsky the formal assurance that in the case of German victory, the war wasn't decided yet then, the Polish state would be recreated at the expense of Russia. This plan was part of the intention to pushing Russia further eastwards, a Western idea even with the Ukraine crisis. Ensuring Germany's economic preponderance in Russia and creating some buffer states on Russia's western boundaries. A few days later, Bethmann Hollweg instructed the German envoy in Stockholm to offer any insurgent Finnish groups against Russian rule the prospect of creating an independent Finland. Similarly, the German Foreign Secretary informed the German ambassador in Vienna that the creation of buffer states between the Central Powers and Russia would be desirable. One of the German aims was to separate Ukraine from Russia. This intention was part of the German planning well before the Russian defeat in East Prussia at the end of August, and has been the aim of Germany in the First and Second World War. Kurt Rietzler, the Chancellor's assistant, whose diaries were published after Fischer's book were published originally, also referred in his diaries to plans in the East, but more specifically to Austrianist intentions to annex the whole of Poland. Rietzler regretted that nothing had been elaborated before Germany's support for Austria had been offered by Germany, so it shows that the consultation wasn't very close. For military reasons, the German military had argued for the proclamation of an independent Polish state, but had not taken the Austrian position into account. The Germans wanted an independent Polish state in order to raise a Polish army on the German side. But whatever was to be done, the two Central Powers had still to work out how to deal with Poland. But one point was clear. Germany's policymakers were unwilling to accept a solution which would mainly satisfy Austrian interests. Later, the fate of Poland was discussed again. But German aims in the East were not as specific as in the September program, which concentrated on aims in the West where the main battle raged. And it's very interesting, if you think of that, that the East was not, at that time, very prominent in German war aims discussion. It was still thought by German conservatives that a separate peace could be worked out with Russia early enough. And secondly, that there was really no conflict of interest between Russia and Germany. The conflict was mainly with France militarily, and then also with Britain worldwide. And it's interesting that that the point about Eastern Europe is sort of on the side. But Bethmann-Hollweg had early on, in early August, already dreamt of Riga and Odessa becoming German, but he later abandoned that again. So we have, despite the fact that the September program is the first program and written down, it doesn't include a very active side on the eastern side. So something about Poland need to be done, but that was really all. There is, of course, one important source which I value very highly. That's a navy attaché writing to Tirpitz, the German Secretary of the Navy, in August, early August 1914, and discusses three war aims: Central Africa, Central Europe, and Eastern expansion. And it's interesting that this letter is written by a military official and shows that in Germany the discussion reached quite different channels of the government. It wasn't only the Chancellor and the Foreign Secretary. There were all sorts of people who made submissions to the government on what Germany ought to achieve in terms of victory from the Allies. The colonial aims are the easiest one to agree, because from the Pan-Germans onwards, from Bethmann-Hollweg, from Rathenau, Central Congo, and the French colonies should become really German. And that, of course, has something to do with the German colonial empire, which had bits in Africa, but wasn't linked up in any way. Max Weber thought this was most regrettable, but even Max Weber advocated German colonial aims in the First World War, the German Middle Africa. And that was the war aims program by the German colonial secretary, with all the colonial groups supporting this. Then comes the second topic, Middle Europa. Now this is, of course, in the argument of Neil Ferguson, predating the European Union, but it wasn't like that at all. Middle Europa meant German domination of the border states over Belgium, the Scandinavian countries, Holland, Switzerland, Italy, and then a particular solution had to be found about France once it was defeated. But as Rietzler put it forward, and I think that's quite interesting, this is the most civilized task Germany could undertake. Europe has only a chance to survive if it created a Central European Association of States based on economic cooperation. That they later couldn't agree what the cooperation should look like is another matter. And Austria was very nervous not to be dominated by Germany industrially. So Rietzler himself advocated the creation of vassal states around Germany, whereas the Foreign Secretary was in favor of partitioning Belgium. Interesting point again. According to Bethmann, the Kaiser also preferred to annex Belgium. The Kaiser advocated the idea of annexing some territory in the West to throw the incumbent population out, ethnic cleansing, and resettled it with deserving NCOs and soldiers. These military colonies were to protect Germany's newly extended boundaries. In the light of the differing demands, the Chancellor no longer believed he was able to keep Belgium intact. Instead, he preferred them to divide between France, Holland, and Germany. So we have got a whole range of solutions about Belgium: to divide it, to annex it, to have a German corridor to the coast, but all things are possible, and was not quite clear what will work out in the end. The funniest thing to me was that even the King of Bavaria came to the German headquarters to announce Bavaria's annexationist wishes, which included the Alsace, Belgium, and the Dutch Rhenish estuary. There was not a war with Holland at all. This shows how far the discussion of war aims has affected various groups and politicians. It had become a political theme, whether more modest or unrealistically expensive. At the time, Bethmann elaborated his World September program. He seemed to have integrated the various proposals made to him and gave the final version, which Rietzler drafted in his own coloring. The creation of a German-dominated Middle Europa, Middle Africa, and territorial acquisitions in the East. He sent the memorandum to his deputy in Berlin, Delbrück, and reminded him that they had discussed Central European Association shortly after the outbreak of the war in early August. The general objective was to establish, and I quote Bethmann's point, security for the German Empire in the East and the West for the foreseeable future. And here we have a defensive aim which sounds defensive, but isn't really defensive at all. And that security is the argument which is intellectually very clever of Bethmann Hollwig to develop that, because that appeals to Germans that they're defining a defensive war to establish German security in the East and the West. He called it Sicherung, even in a speech in the Reichstag in December 1915. He wasn't very specific, but the moment he mentioned the word that Germany is fighting for Sicherung, the right applauded him, the conservatives and the national liberals. After that speech, the editor of the Berlin Tageblatt, who was a non-annexationist, took Bethmann Hollweg to task, saying that he has changed the camp and became an annexationist. So Bethmann and Wolf, the editor, met. And it's interesting, one of the most interesting statements about Bethmann's policies, which has only been published a few years ago when the Wolf Tagebücher or diaries were published for the first time. And it shows how Bethmann weaved his arguments around not to alienate people, to be properly understood on the right, but also acceptable by the liberals or the left. So that was his famous talk of Sicherung. But in the September program, the next few sentences make it clear that war was at stake. Accordingly, France was to be reduced as a great power, and Russia should be thrust eastwards, and its powers over the non-Russian people, presumably the Ukraine, Poland, and the Baltic provinces, be broken, but probably not the Russian domination in Central Asia. The Chancellor wanted to leave the final decisions to the military, such as the acquisition of Belfort, the western slopes of the Vosges Mountains, and the coastal strip from Dunkirk to Boulogne. But it's not clear whether military circles had made these demands directly. It looks as if these suggestions came from the governor of Alsace-Lorraine. We can now trace down, source position is quite good, who made what suggestion. So I come to the end. I would like to say that it's very interesting that quite a lot of early war aims programs, and the interesting thing is that Moltke, Ludendorff, and Hindenburg made relatively modest claims, but changed them later during the war. Later during the war, which is important. So we can say it is the topic for the German political elite to think how Germany would dominate Europe in the case of victory. And it's interesting, final remarks, interesting that that was, the First World War was won by Germany in 1940. The German war aims which Germany had thought of in the First World War were all realized in the Second World War. France was subjugated, Holland and Belgium were annexed, and Poland destroyed, and the expansion on the Balkans started in 1941. So all these aims which were discussed in the First World War were practically run through very quickly as German aims in the Second World War and actually achieved. So that one can say that Germany won the First World War in 1940. That it lost it later again is another matter on another side. But that's quite interesting if one talks of continuity between the First and the Second World War. And with that, I would like to thank you for your concentration. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to Can I be heard with this thing? Is it working? I'd like to begin by thanking Vuk Jeremic and the CIRSD for inviting us to this conference and for setting up this wonderful panel with these colleagues that I admire very much. I think it's for me particularly significant that we're in a place which is situated on one of the fault lines where the aftershocks of the cataclysm initiated in 1914 are still being felt. And so I think that in a way our thoughts about this subject carry more weight here than they do elsewhere, and that also is something of great interest to an historian. Okay, so I wanted to begin by engaging a little bit with the Fischer thesis that Hartmut Pogge von Strandmann has so eloquently spoken about, and just sharing a few thoughts with you about that thesis. I mean, what Fischer, it seems to me, essentially did, and I want to focus on his writings about the origins of the war, not about his writings on peace aims. I mean, there's a very interesting literature on the peace aims of the various different belligerent blocs, belligerent states. Jean-Henri Soutou's L'Or et le Sang is an absolutely magisterial overview of these problems, which sets the German peace aims, or war aims, whichever you want to call them, in the context of the war and peace aims of the other belligerent states. I want to focus on what Fischer had to say about the origins of the war, and as Hartmut rightly says, Fischer initially wasn't very interested in that question. His first book was about war aims, but he then, as the controversy took off around the question of Germany's responsibility for the outbreak of the war, a controversy of tremendous importance for the history of the German Federal Republic in its post-war phase, Fischer got deeper and deeper into the question of war, of the war's origins, and of Germany's prominent place in the causation of that war. And what Fischer effectively did was he drew a kind of psychogram of the German elites. It's about the inner life of a political elite, characterized, as he showed, using at that time an unprecedented breadth and depth of source material. A lot of these sources were already available in print, but he put them together, he synthesized them in a very persuasive way to draw a kind of collective portrait of a political elite which was paranoid, aggressive, which oscillated between arrogance about its own achievements and its own strength on the one hand, and anxiety and fear about the future on the other. Hartmut has already referred to the really paranoid preoccupation with Russian strength, with the growth in Russian strength, financed, as the Germans saw it, by vast loans from Paris. They were constantly, the general staff spent most of its time doing mathematical sums, working out the difference between the total number of troops on the Russo-French alliances side and those on the Central Powers. By 1914, they had a discrepancy of 1 million more men. They calculated that gap would have risen to over 2 million by 1917. The focus was always on this future moment when things would be much worse for Germany than they were in the present. And this nourished a kind of paranoia, a combination of fear and aggression. Fischer also made a number of other arguments. He claimed that in December 1912, the Germans went beyond simply feeling paranoid and aggressive and hatching vague ideas about hegemony to actually planning a war. And he suggested that in something called the Council of War in December 1912, the Germans deliberately set about not only to plan a war, but they determined the timing of its outbreak, that it would break out in the summer of 1914. So that, if you like, is the kind of core of the claim that Fischer made about Germany. It was this psychogram marked by aggression and paranoia combined with actual planning for an actual war. And this, now, what's left of that view now, if we look at how the literature has evolved? Well, quite a lot is left, but not all of it. The contention that the Germans planned war at the War Council of 1912 is now accepted by virtually nobody. I mean, that argument no longer holds water. There is no evidence that the Germans planned a war timed to break out in 1912. I can think of only one colleague, whom I won't name now, who wholeheartedly endorses this view. But what I think does remain is the power of Fischer's very persuasive psychological portrait of parts of the German political and military elites. That, I think, remains in place. And, of course, what also remains is the immense value of what Fischer achieved in stimulating this controversy about war aims. Because at the time when the Fischer controversy broke out, and this controversy soon took on a kind of a scale that I think even Fisher can't possibly have imagined. I mean, Fisher was a very publicity-minded historian. He sent copies of all his books to every journalist that he knew before they were published. So he wanted media coverage, but I think even he cannot have predicted the immensity of the controversy that he would prompt. But this controversy did have a clarifying effect on the sort of intelligentsia, if you like, of the German Federal Republic. Up until that point, the predominant view had been that the Germans were effectively innocent in the outbreak of the First World War. It was still viewed as a defensive war, or at the very best, a war into which all the powers had slithered, a war that had sort of simply occurred because everybody slipped into it sort of by accident. And the famous formula of David Lloyd George, that the states of Europe slithered over the brink into catastrophe, was very widely quoted. And Fisher did a great deal to restore to the Germans their share, I mean, a share that he regarded as vast, as not just prominent, but effectively amounting to virtually sole responsibility and therefore also to guilt. He played a very important role in restoring to Germany its place in the responsibility for the outbreak of this war. Okay, so where do I see the problems of this approach? Well, it seems to me the main problem with Fisher is that Fisher was really only interested in Germany. He wasn't interested in any of the other European states. He had, of course, one, we can't be experts on everything, as I've recently discovered with my own book. You know, we can't be authoritative on everything we write about. It's just impossible, especially if you're dealing with Europe, such a diverse continent with such a complex and deep history in all of its nations and regions. But Fisher didn't even ask his research students to go and work on Russia or France or the other states. He was really only interested in Germany. It was very much a parochial view turned inwards on the Germans themselves, which means that what we now call international relations actually plays virtually no role in Fisher's analysis. It was an analysis about what the Germans were thinking and feeling, and the plans that they were hatching in their councils and in the sort of councils and discussions of the most senior men. So that's part of the problem, and that of course is connected with the moral focus of Fisher's argument. Now, Fisher had very good reasons for pursuing this campaign for German responsibility as a moral campaign, and some of the most interesting recent writing on Fisher has shown how this campaign for German war responsibility was anchored in his own biography, in his own proximity at one point in his life, something he later deeply and sincerely regretted, to National Socialism, at his desire, as he made clear in various contexts, especially during visits to the United States, to contribute to the process of Vergangenheitsbewältigung, of coming to terms with the appalling moral legacy of the criminality of the Third Reich. But the problem with a morally driven focus of this kind is precisely that it narrows the field of vision. Above all, it excludes from view the multilateral character, the multinational, multi-state character of the crises that brought Europe, that made European peace more and more fragile. That seems to me it's the deepest problem about this argument. Another problem is that it assigns very high levels of consistency and cohesion to the German decision-making apparatus, suggesting that plans were hatched, they became a consistent policy of the leadership as a whole, whereas in fact what we know about how the German executive worked, but for that matter how all the European executives worked, is that in fact the executive structures of Europe on the eve of 1914 were extremely openly structured. There were numerous plans being hatched in parallel. It's not the case that all active politicians felt themselves bound by a particular line of policy. It's often very difficult to say what the policy of any one of these executives is at any particular time. And then there's the fact that we simply lose from view the complex triangulations of policy in Europe before 1914. Out of the Fisher thesis comes an idea that all of European policy is determined in Germany. I'm thinking now about an argument that I had with my colleague John Röhl, a very respected colleague. I have a lot of time for his work. He's done a lot of work on William II, wonderful biography of the Kaiser. And John and I were arguing about this on British radio. And John said, well, the problem with Chris Clark's view of the outbreak of the First World War is it's like describing the solar system, but leaving out the sun. Because, and I thought to myself, what an interesting metaphor that is. Germany is the sun. The other planets, the other countries are just planets floating in the orbit, in the gravitational force of this immense power. Now, that is certainly not how I see the affairs of the European continent before 1914. This is a very complex world, peopled by numerous great powers, including one hyperpower, one unipolar dominant great power, which is neither Germany nor Russia, but Great Britain, still the top dog, as it were, in the international system. A world in which every one of these powers had more than one enemy. It was a threat-rich environment for all the participants in this game, if we can call it a game. And one way of thinking beyond the Fisher thesis is to think, for example, beyond the idea that the European alliance structures that emerge between 1900 and, or between the 1890s and 1914, the triple entente on the one side and the central powers on the other, is to think beyond the idea that these are simply the consequence of German provocations and German actions, and to recall that, for example, the British alliance with Japan in 1902, a really shocking event for European intelligentsias of that year, the first ever alliance between an East Asian and a European state, is the consequence of British fear of and hostility towards Russia. Britain buys into the Japanese fleet building program in order to acquire a balance against Russia in the Far East. The Entente in 1904 is not simply an instrument devised, the Entente between Britain and France, devised to counter German hegemonial ambitions. It's also an anti-Russian instrument to pull the French gently out of their relationship. Their alliance with Russia is part of the objective of 1904. And the UPCOM, the convention between the Anglo-Russian convention of 1907, is again a power-sharing agreement in Central Asia, whose purpose is to appease the Russians, to try and tether them, because the British still see, with good reason, from their point of view, the Russians as a threat to Britain's world possessions, in particular to its possessions in India, which it regards still as the jewel in the imperial crown. And in fact, a lot of the most interesting writing on the crises that come before the world before the World War of 1914-18 has been a tendency to globalize the field of vision, to recognize that these stories are not just European stories, that the rising importance of China, for example, Thomas Otte has written a wonderful book about the China question, showing how increasing tension over China produces deepening distrust between Britain and Russia. It also produces the Russo-Japanese War, which again is fought out over. It was interesting to hear Vuk Jeremic talk today about the prominence of the Korean Peninsula. Well, the Korean Peninsula is at the center of the geopolitical rivalries of 1904-5. The point is that this is not a safe, lovely world, a sunlit suburban park into which a psychopathic maniac in the form of the German great power simply bursts, inflicting violence in all directions. It's a complex world marked by complex multipolar rivalries, which are multipolar and multidirectional, and which force all of these powers to triangulate their policies, managing the policy with each other power in the light of the threats that they perceive from the environment as a whole. So in my own reflections on this problem, I tried to move beyond the Fisher-centered, or what Sam Williamson Jr. calls the German paradigm, by asking not why did this war break out, because the question why has often essentially meant who. Not why did the war break out, but who did this terrible thing? And the answer has most often been Germany, though recently it's become fashionable to blame Russia, a view which I don't myself share. But nonetheless, the question why has often meant who. And in moving beyond that, I tried asking instead the question how. How did peace become war? What are the developments, the actions, the transitions, the decisions that made war more likely? And when you ask the question that way, you come up with all sorts of things that simply don't fit into the Fisher paradigm because they have absolutely nothing to do with either a Fisher or an anti-Fisher position. They're not revisionist arguments, they're just arguments that operate outside that paradigm. And one example would be to give, in my view, that its deserved prominence to the Italian war on Libya in 1911. Now, in 1911, the Italians, in a completely unprovoked attack, assaulted or launched a sort of air-sea assault, is what you'd now call it, I suppose, on Cyrenaica, Fezzan, and Tripolitania. In other words, the three vilayets of the Ottoman Empire, now known as Libya. Since the 1930s, they've been known as Libya. Now, the interesting thing about this war is, quite apart from the fact that this is the first war ever to see aerial bombardments, the interesting thing about this war is that it was a crucial way station towards the First World War. It flashed a green light to the Balkan states this is now a free-for-all. Anyone can take what they want from what remains of the Ottoman Empire, the Ottoman Empire in Europe. And a man who understood Balkan affairs better than almost any other statesman of his time, Miroslav Spalajković, the former head of the political department of the foreign ministry here in Belgrade, in a very interesting interview with a French journalist after the First World War, referred to the Italian assault on Libya as, he said, ça c'était la première agression. They were speaking in French. He said, that was the first aggression. Out of this first aggression unfolded all the other aggressions, the two Balkan wars, the Great War, and so on. And we find Stéphane Pichon, the former French foreign minister, in 1916, reflecting on the outbreak of the war. He too points to the Libyan War of 1911 as a crucial starting point for the fragilization, as it's sometimes called, of European peace. Now, this doesn't mean that I want to suggest the Italians are to blame. We found a new culprit. It's Rome. It's not Berlin. It's Rome. That would be ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. My idea was to get beyond the blaming, the moralizing approach of the Fisher thesis towards an approach which is open to the complex ways in which risks accumulate in different parts of Europe. One further example, which I know is contentious and is controversial, concerns the way in which the character of the Franco-Russian alliance changes in the last couple of years before the outbreak of war. Until the end of 1911, Paris had always warned Russia, under no circumstances will Paris support Russia in any kind of démarche on the Balkans. Paris does not recognize in the Balkan Peninsula a vital interest either for Russia or for Paris. That was absolutely clear, and these warnings were repeated on numerous occasions. In other words, as Patricia Weitzman has pointed out, this alliance, the Franco-Russian alliance, functioned as a tethering alliance. It wasn't one which escalated the general international environment. It was one which tethered this great power, and Russia did the same to France. Russia warned France, don't think that we will support you in a démarche for Morocco. Russia does not recognize in Morocco a vital interest for France, let alone for Russia, using exactly the same words that France had used in its warnings to St. Petersburg. But that changes in 1912, when Raymond Poincaré, as foreign minister and président du Conseil, the president of the Council of Ministers, begins to assure the Russians that in the event of a conflict breaking out in the Balkans, the French will stand by the Russians diplomatically, and if the Germans intervene on behalf of Austria following a Russian mobilization against Austria, then militarily as well. And that, of course, is a further step which raises the risk, which fragilizes peace. That does not mean that we found yet another culprit, the French or the Franco-Russian alliance. Now we have a new and someone new to put in the frame of responsibility, because we know that this expansion of the remit of the alliance was not a war plan. It was not a conspiracy to bring about a war. On the contrary, it was a conception that emerged from France's defensive anxieties. Why is it particularly in this period, 1213, that Poincaré begins to change the message, to change the signals to St. Petersburg? Not because he wants a war with Germany, but because he fears the growing strength of the German army. He fears Germany's demographic growth. He worries about France drifting into permanent inferiority vis-a-vis its powerful neighbor, whose aggression and paranoia Poincaré well understands. He was a native of Lorraine. He came from Bar-le-Duc, which was overrun by the Germans in the 1870 war. So it's not just that. It's also that the French feel less and less that they can count on the British, because Edward Grey has been disciplined by his own non-interventionists within the British cabinet. He started telling the French, I'm not sure you can count on us. Our hands remain free. You shouldn't count on us. And as they become more and more worried about British support, the French, for perfectly understandable reasons, it's an intelligent policy, begin to cling more and more tightly to Russia, whose power is massively overestimated, not just by the Germans. I mean, Hartmut's right about that. There's an extraordinary tendency to think of Russia as this, as going through an explosion of military striking power. This is not the case, but that's how it's seen in Berlin. But not just in Berlin. In Paris, too, the power of Russia is hugely overstated, partly because Russia is really going through a period of very rapid industrial growth. But it's the idea that this translates into military power, into military striking power, is, of course, in retrospect, we know, a delusion. But it's a delusion into which all of these policymakers very quickly buy. There's a sort of rhetorical bubble around Russia in the run-up to 1914. Well, how does Serbia fit into this problem? And I know that my writings on this subject have been particularly contentious and particularly open to criticism. And I really just want to restrict what I want to, my thoughts just to a few points. The first is that I'm just going to mention a particular source, which is a letter sent by Sazonov, the Russian foreign minister, to the British, the Russian envoy, I'm sorry, in Belgrade, Hartwig, or Gartwig, as he was known, to his Russian colleagues. Count Gartwig is the representative of Russian interests in Belgrade, and Sazonov writes him a letter in 1913, where he says, "Could you please tell Mr. Pašić that the Serbs should stop looking..." He's referring, of course, to Nikola Pašić. This is the one audience where I don't need to tell anyone who Nikola Pašić is. He says, "Could you please tell Mr. Pašić that the Serbs should stop looking to Macedonia for their future promised land? Because in Macedonia, they're only going to wind up getting caught up with the Bulgarians. That is not a good idea. We don't want that. No, they should focus on Bosnia and Herzegovina, the Vojvodina. They should focus on the lands of Austria-Hungary, because Austria-Hungary is dying. The signs of its decomposition can be everywhere to see. This thing is moribund. The future is coming. It's coming fast. There's going to be a bitter conflict, a bitter war. The Serbs should prepare themselves for that. But the future lies in the lands of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy, not in Macedonia." Now, one can see why Sazonov is doing this. And one can understand very well what his thinking is, why he wants to move the focus of Serbian policy away from Macedonia. It makes sense. It's the old leaguist policy, the Balkan League policy, which enables Russia not to have to choose between its friends on the Balkans, Bulgaria and Serbia. But surely this was also a risk-enhancing initiative. It was a risk-enhancing initiative to allow Serbia to become, to see Serbia as a kind of client. Now, we know that Serbia never became, to my knowledge, has never been a client of anyone. And this is a mistake when great powers think that they can secure the services of client states, that the clients are never, in fact, clients. That's a mistake that is presumably going to continue being made by our political leaderships, though one hopes one day it will stop. To this one has to, so in other words, I want to make a key point here. Yes, Serbia was passing through a period of political turbulence at this point. The evidence of that is clear. We have the priority crisis of 1914, where there's a severe breakdown in civil-military relations. But this does not mean that Serbia was a rogue state. I have never, ever claimed that Serbia was a rogue state, though it's been claimed about me by people who I can only assume have not read my book. It was not a rogue state, and I have never claimed that it was. It was a European state, which had, of course, an issue with some out-of-control elements within its own intelligence apparatus, networks operating under only partial control of the state authorities, but it was not a rogue state. Nevertheless, it's true, I think, that here too, in the Balkans, one can see risks accumulating. And of course, here we're up against the limits, if you like, of the moral approach, because the point about political operations of the Serbian, what we might call a Serbian irredenta, Serbian nationalism, Serbian networks, national networks at this time, whether they're operating within Serbia itself or in Macedonia or in neighboring Bosnia-Herzegovina. The point is, it was not wrong for Serbs, for the Serbian state, to seek to expand Serbia's national boundaries, because the Serbs were not seeking anything that the Italians and the Germans had not already achieved. The Italians and the Germans had established nation states by means of war in the 19th century. It's not for nothing that the Journal of the Black Hand called itself Piemont, right? This was the model was the Italian Wars of Unification. So the point I'm making here is that Serbia is simply part of a default European setting, the pursuit of a national home, a national framework, if necessary, by a process of military conflict and through violence. The moral question of whether this was wrong is completely irrelevant. It goes absolutely past the question. It's at cross purposes with what actually matters about the situation in the Balkans. So to conclude, the question then arises, do we really want or need to return to the simplicities of the German paradigm of the Fischer thesis, to a model of a solar system in which all the other powers just revolve harmlessly around a German sun? Well, it seems to me that this is not the way our thinking should be evolving. There's a reason why we're all sitting here talking about the origins of the First World War. There's a reason why after 100 years we're still puzzling over it, and it has nothing to do with the anniversary, though it does have to do with the fact that the problems we experienced and failed to master in 1914 are still with us. And this is something that Vuk Jeremic rightly hinted at in his comments. He rightly referred to the fact that we're once again in a multipolar, complex world marked by low levels of trust, high levels of paranoia, and a multilateral environment of threat where everybody sees more than one potential adversary. So my argument, my plea would be to take the complexity of the events that brought war in 1914, to take that complexity seriously and not to fall back into the comfortable certainties of a world where we know who's to blame. We can point the finger, pleasurable as it is, to point the finger at the man in the dock and say, we have the culprit. It seems to me that is not the way to understand what happened in 1914, and certainly not a good way to understand what may happen in the future that our own present has in store. Thank you very much.
Well, firstly, of course, my thanks for the invitation. I very much sympathized with Vuk Jeremic's introduction. I myself have just handed in my book on the origins of Russia's First World War and of the Russian Revolution. I wrote it mostly living in my house halfway up a mountain in Japan, where I spend half of every year. And if you're thinking about the origins of the First World War and living amidst the growing geopolitical rivalries and nationalist excitements of East Asia, your life is not very comforting. Slightly to lower the tone, I would say also in introduction that I think this is probably the first speech of any sort made by a member of my family in Belgrade for 200 years. The first Russian envoy, if you like, to autonomous Serbia was my great-great-great-great-great-uncle, 90 times removed, who, like anybody of any importance in Russia in those days, was a general. He was unfortunately, like his descendant, a little podgy, and Russian generals wore very tight white trousers. And according to the family tradition, panic spread in Belgrade that when the honorable Russian envoy had to sit on an Ottoman-style divan, his trousers might split, to the great humiliation of Russia. So the evening before he had his meeting with Kara George, they built a sofa for him of proper dimensions. This is probably an entirely false story, but it is part of the family tradition. On to more serious matters. It seems to me that first and foremost, and contrary to virtually everything which is written, certainly in the English-speaking world, the First World War was above all else an East European war. By East Europe, I include Southeast Europe and Constantinople and the Straits. The war's origins lie in the decline of the Ottoman Empire. I completely agree with Chris about the importance of the Libyan conflict. They lie in the collapse of the Ottoman Empire spreading from Libya to the Balkans, and to the deep fears, hopes that the jewel in the crown of the Ottoman Empire, Constantinople and indeed the Straits, is coming up for grabs too. From there you go on to July 1914 itself, which I see as Austria really using the assassination of Franz Ferdinand as an excuse to turn Serbia into a protectorate. A very, very usual policy in the world of high imperialism. The Austrians are not doing anything which their imperial rivals have not done across the globe. In many ways, the Western powers, certainly the British and French, are pulled into someone else's war almost by accident. By accident is a silly word. They're pulled in for fears of the European balance of power and therefore their own security. Should Germany and Austria defeat Russia and become dominant in East Central Europe, and therefore in Europe as a whole. The First World War is won on the Western Front, but the peace of 1919 is lost in Eastern Europe, and that for very obvious reasons. More than anything else, as I've said, the First World War originates in a struggle between the Germanic powers and Russia for the domination of Central and Eastern Europe. It ends, contrary to any prediction, with the defeat of all three East European empires, the disintegration of Austria leaving a huge geopolitical void in Central Europe, and both Germany and Russia defeated and excluded from the peace settlement. The Versailles Order is not merely based on American intervention in Europe and American power, and therefore immediately undermined by America's retreat into isolation. But even without that, it was deeply vulnerable because of the fact that you cannot build a European settlement, a stable one, against the two most powerful countries, potentially, in continental Europe. They are Germany and Russia. By attempting to build a stable Europe against Germany and against Russia, you more or less doom the post-war settlement to destruction. And that is even before you take into account the horrible ideologies which came to power in Germany and Russia to a very great extent as a result of the First World War. In many ways, Russia's First World War, anyway, ends in May 1945, when the Soviet Army takes Berlin. But part of the enormous tragedy for Russia and for Europe of the Revolution of 1917 is that by taking Russia out of the war, and meaning that Russia does not play any role in the rebuilding of European stability in 1919, the wretched Russian people have to fight the First World War twice. It is, in a sense, symbolic that only now, for the first time, are monuments going up in the memory of the 2 million Russians who died in the First World War. They were forgotten in every way. That, then, is my introduction. It seems to me, more fundamentally, that the First World War comes out of what you might describe as the dilemma of modern empire, or perhaps of modern international relations. The basic point is that in the pre-1914 world, if you are going to be a great power, it is more or less universally assumed that you have to be an empire. That is, if you were a European state. And there are all sorts of reasons for this, probably the most fundamental being the rise of the United States to a level of potential power by 1900, which makes it absolutely clear to any observer that no purely European state is going to be able to match American power and be a true great power in the 20th century. The only way you can match the United States is by having resources of a continental scale. And for most European countries, that can only be done through empire. It is believed that if Britain can consolidate its white empire, and there are attempts to do so, it may, in the long run, be able to match the United States. If Russia can maintain its existing empire and develop it, the same may be true. For the other more purely continental European powers, the dilemmas are even more difficult and the outlook, in one sense, even more pessimistic. But there is a very nasty contradiction. The logic of international power may point to empire, but the logic of domestic politics points to nationalism, in almost all cases ethnically defined within the way of thinking of that pre-war world, which very much stresses the power of blood, race, etc., 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 as the foundations of collective identity. How do you find some kind of version of nationalism which will legitimize a polity of continental scale? Not easy. The basic idea that nationalism is the way to legitimize governments, to consolidate communities, is, unless you are a Marxist socialist, more or less taken for granted by most Europeans and certainly by most European rulers. And it does create a most horrible dilemma. You've got the fundamental logic of international relations and of domestic politics pointing in opposite directions. Now, nationalism, of course, in the metropolitan people may feed in to imperialism. nationalism in the minority peoples of an empire is likely to prove its nemesis. Now, I realize that this is a deeply unfashionable line to take in among modern historians. We are told that we must not buy into master narratives, and we are told that we must certainly reject the predominantly national and nationalist perspectives through which history has mostly been written. I have an enormous amount of sympathy for that idea. It does seem to me that the nationalist paradigm is not merely often false, but also dangerous. I did, after all, write a book comparing empires. If you were going to accuse me of wickedness, it would certainly be imperialist rather than nationalist wickedness, for all sorts of rather obvious autobiographical and family reasons. I think it's perfectly fair to point to the fact that empire was a good deal stronger than people imagined in 1914. The Austrian Empire actually put up quite an effective performance in many ways in the First World War, so even did the Ottomans. Anybody who knows anything about contemporary Asia will realize that many of its greatest states, thank God, India, Indonesia, Iran, the obvious examples, are the exact antithesis of the European definition of ethnic nationality as the basis for statehood and sovereignty. So I fully subscribe to suspicion of the dominant narrative and the idea that the nation, as defined by Europeans and by European history, must be universal, has the blessing of God and history behind it. Indeed, I go as far to say that if Asia catches the European nationalist disease, and the great states of Indonesia, India, Iran, and elsewhere become subject to these kind of nationalist pressures, probably the planet won't survive. But we must not take things too far. In the first place, even if it is true that nationalism was much less powerful, much less all-conquering than people imagined before 1914, the fact that they did imagine it, the fact that this was their perception, is of huge importance. The fact, for instance, that the rulers of Vienna thought that history was against them, that ethnic nationalism was a disease almost inevitable with the modernization of societies, mass literacy, urbanization, etc. The perception is crucial to how they acted in 14. And then again, you simply can't throw out the reality of nationalism's power without throwing out all sense of much of the core, the essence of 20th century history. The struggle between empire and nationalism defines much of history, both in Europe and outside, and the division between Europe and the rest of the world is actually a fantasy. Now, I said that the war was, in its origins, an East European war, and I think that's right. But the basic struggle between empire and nationalism is, of course, not East European, it's global. Even in 1914, the British polity is more or less paralyzed by the Irish crisis, which has enormous similarities to the problems which the Austrian Empire is facing. It seems to me that Suez in 1956 is the 1914 moment of the British and French empires. You know, facing growing decline, despairing of your global role and status, face to face with rising nationalist movements, in this case in the Middle East. In a way, the key difference between 1956 and 1914 is that Anglo-French silliness is brought to a rapid end by the senior brother in Washington, unlike the senior brother in Berlin in 1914. So without in any sense denying that contingency was crucial in 1914, without the assassination, almost certainly there would not have been a European war in 14. There might well have been a European war in 16 or 17 or sometime, but that might have been a very different war. It might have been a war in which Britain was not initially involved. In that case, Germany would almost certainly have won that European war, for better or worse. We are, after all, back in a situation where we were before 14. If there is to be any leadership in Europe, it has got to come from Germany. somehow we have got to find a means whereby German leadership in Europe is acceptable to other Europeans and to the Germans themselves. So where does Russia fit into all of this? Well, as I've said, I've just finished and handed in a rather large book on this subject, and it is not easy to summarize a large book in 5 minutes, so I shan't try. If you want to ask me about the July crisis in Russia, please do so. If you want to ask me about Russian military planning and about Russian perceptions about what a future European war was going to be like, a crucial issue, please ask me. If you want to ask me about Russian-Serb relationship, please ask me. I did spend a year in the Russian archives. There is an enormous amount of interesting new material on all these issues. Actually, the first line of my new book, which I hasten to add was written in the first draft of the book long before the current crisis in Ukraine, was that as much as anything else, the First World War revolved around the future of Ukraine. So again, ask if you want to understand why I said this. But all I'm going to do right now is just to summarize very briefly what seemed to me to be the bases of Russian foreign policy before 14, which really underpin also Russian behavior in the July crisis. It seems to me that Russian policy is really driven by three factors. One is security. One is interests, or if you're a rival of Russia, ambitions. And the third is identity. And they will be very familiar to anybody who has anything to do with international relations, past, present, or future. Security means, above all else, fear of German power. Or fear, you might say, after the 1879 dual alliance, of Germanic power. Germany is unequivocally, in those three decades before the First World War, potentially the most powerful country in Europe, even on its own, even without the Austrian alliance. It is in the nature of international relations to fear powerful neighbors, and you can go right back to the ancient Greeks and to ancient Chinese history to find the same basic strategy which Russia adopts in the face of this reality, which is to find a fellow rival of German power, a fellow country which fears German hegemony, on the other side of your rival, and that's called France, and that is the dual alliance. You can make it more sophisticated by invoking ideas about balance of power and seeing their roots in both European geopolitics and in European history and in European thinking about international security right back through the 19th century. Russian interests, or if you like, ambitions, are, as regards the run-up to 1914, above all to do with the Ottoman inheritance, which means the Balkans and Constantinople and the Straits. Strictly defined interests, I think, in the Balkans are, as much as anything else, in fact, they are more than anything else, broadly speaking, the idea that this is part of a European alliance to check potential German hegemony, and more specifically, that the link with Serbia means six less Austrian corps on the Eastern Front. And that is absolutely explicit in the Russian archives, no question of it. At the Straits, the interests are both strategic, avoiding a future Crimean War in which overpowering enemy naval and military forces will penetrate the Black Sea and challenge Russian security, and above all else, economics, commercially related. The majority of Russian exports go through the Straits. That is going to become an even more extreme factor as the southern Russian, Ukrainian, and southeast Russian economy booms. Those exports are almost all very bulky. There is no alternative to taking them through the Straits by sea. On those exports depends Russia's entire economic well-being and future. As for identity, it is partly a question of Russia as the leader of the Slav world, rooted sometimes in conceptions of Slavophilism, Russia's unique civilization, Russia's difference to Latin Europe, but its place as the inevitable leader and protector of the Slav world. It's also, though, and this is even more widespread, and it's held by people who are in no sense Slavophiles, like Alexander Benkendorf, the ambassador in London, or Nicholas von der Ostensacken, the ambassador in Berlin, who, by their very names, are not likely to be the most passionate of pan-Slavs. They believe that Russian history and Russians, suffering Russia's commitment in the past to the Balkans, means that you cannot simply turn your back on that history and allow the Germanic powers to dominate the Balkans. But it is even more the case, if one's talking about identity, that for the whole Russian elite, but particularly for the policy-making elite, being a great power is absolutely essential to their identity as Russians and to their conception about Russia's importance in the world, its historical role, its entire being, if you like. Now, you don't need me to tell you that interests, security, and identity are closely linked. That's obvious. You know, you take the issue of the Balkans. This is an issue of identity, Slavdom. It's an issue of building up, as the Russians see it, a barrier to German power. And that is even more obvious if you look at what it means to be a great power. This is identity, this is security, this is status, this is interest, this is everything. I think an important point to make, and here again I come back, you know, to agreeing with Chris, it is fatal to look at the origins of the First World War from any purely national perspective. It makes no sense. You have to put things in the context. And if you're looking at Russian perceptions of security, interest, or identity before 1914, the obvious point to make is that Russia is anything but as exotic as either its great enemies or its dearest friends, including the Russians themselves, often believe. Balance of power is pretty obvious. The perspective in the Russian Foreign Ministry is virtually identical to the perspective in London. The balance of power is the basis of European security. As to interests, you know, I'm not entirely against what some of these recent books which have been coming out in English, particularly McMeekin, about the extent to which Russia's possible ambitions to grab the Straits, even Constantinople, are a serious factor in European instability. Again, talk to me about this, ask if you want. But it hardly makes sense looking at Russia in a void. After all, the British have grabbed the Suez Canal and taken over the whole of Egypt. The Americans have annexed Panama, you know, and broken up the Colombian Republic. Russia's interests at the Straits, both strategic and above all economic, are much greater than those of Britain at Suez or America at Panama. Not least and above all, because the Russians have no other alternative. There's no Cape of Good Hope, there's no Cape Horn. You have no alternative in terms of both strategic interests and above all commercial ones. So it's meaningless talking about the wickedness of Russian imperialism with its designs on the Straits if you don't think a bit about Suez, Panama, and the broader international pattern. And if you're talking about identity and that slightly misused word pan-Slavism, of course that has specific and very interesting Russian unique origins. But after all, we're living in a world in which increasingly you can see the outlines of great international blocs, which you might define as both geopolitical and ethno-ideological. This is, after all, the Germanic bloc in Eastern Europe, created, you know, in the 50 years before the First World War, against a background of deep Prussian-Austrian rivalry, Catholic-Protestant rivalry, which previously has divided the German world, the Germanic world. And then what about that greatest and ultimately most triumphant of all, the ethno-ideological geopolitical blocs, the Anglo-Americans, on whose victory the geopolitical order, and indeed the moral order to an extent, of the contemporary world rests. So again, Russia is not unique. So I'll come to a conclusion. It seems to me that, to a significant degree anyway, Russian dilemmas before 1914 and before 1939 are roughly the same, which is in a way inevitable. After all, they are living within the same geopolitical reality. In the end, do you seek to come to a deal with the potentially hegemonic German power in Europe, or do you seek to deter it by allying with the flanking powers, Britain and France? Before 1914, Russia adopted a policy of allying with the flanking powers to protect its security, and so it was seen its interests in Europe. I think after 1905 and the defeat in Japan, it is difficult to see how Russia could have avoided such a strategy. You have the professional diplomats concerned with the balance of power and security, allied to similar concerns in Russian society, a strain of anti-Germanism in Russian society, but also a very strong historical sense that Russia's identity requires the defense of the Balkan Slavs and Russia's position at the Straits and in the Balkans. Now, I spent quite a bit of my book looking at the critics within Russia of that strategy. People who argued that above all else, Russia required peace, it required a generation to develop its resources, it required a concentration on Siberia and the maritime provinces as the answer to so many of Russia's domestic problems. It critiqued the idea that Russia must somehow feel itself the protector of the Slavs, arguing that the Slavs themselves were disunited and that actually, unless they needed Russia, they were not loyal to it. And it argued that although the Straits were important, they did, after all, lead into a closed sea, the Mediterranean, all of whose exits were controlled by the British. And although, of course, they didn't say this, it is worth remembering Mussolini's comment that until Italy controlled one of those two exits, it was not a serious great power. So I have a lot of time for the critics of Russian policy before 14, though I think they had little chance of success. The person who, of course, carried out their strategy was Stalin in 1939. He adopted the policy which those critics had suggested to Nicholas. In other words, for God's sake, do not seek to confront potential German hegemony in Europe. We need peace for a generation. Give us a generation, Russia will unequivocally be the most powerful country in Eurasia, but we need that generation. Persuade the Germans to go westwards. Let them take on the French and the British. This will be a conflict which lasts for at least a generation. And in that generation, we will be at peace and we will be in a position to develop our uniquely enormous resources and consolidate our polity. And I think you could argue that the supreme tragedy from the Russian point of view is that maybe they made the wrong choice in both 14 and 39. But the point to make, I think, is not to say that Nicholas was necessarily wrong or that Stalin was wrong. After all, it was not just Stalin who miscalculated in 1939. Virtually nobody, including most German generals, thought that Germany would knock out France, push the British back over the Channel, and dominate Europe in a way that no one had done since Napoleon. It shocked everyone. I think the real point to make is that the choices were exceptionally difficult, the stakes tragically high, above all for the Russian people, but for Europe as a whole, and that, you know, we need to look at the tragedy of 1914 and just hope, and even sort of hope for a certain extra degree of Europe, of human rationality in order not to repeat what happened then. I mean, one point which is not often made, certainly by Europeans as regards the First World War, was that a conflict which was entirely caused by Europeans ended up by destroying the lives of huge numbers of people from other continents. And there are moments, I must say, living in East Asia, when I do rather hope that East Asia will not, as you might politely say, repay the compliment. Thank you. That's all I say. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can't hide you that I feel that I'm in a very awkward position. First of all, I have to speak after illustrious professors, then after these huge perspectives of European and world history, I am obliged to bring you back to the Balkans and speak about, amongst other things, about Serbia. I'm quite sure that we all here in Belgrade would have preferred that we could avoid speaking about Serbia about in July 1914, because Serbia in July 1914 had a very dubious privilege to enter the mainstream of international history in a way that we really did not want to. Nevertheless, I have a task to fulfill, and I will start perhaps with a rather smaller perspective by asking myself why in July 1914 it was impossible to convene an international conference to settle the issue, as was the case in previous numerous previous occasions. As far as I know, after the end of the Franco-Prussian War, the concert of powers, whatever that means, assured the peace in Europe by convoking international conference when a bilateral solution for a given crisis was impossible. Colonial issues, such as Moroccan crisis, or even Balkan ones, such as Great Eastern crisis or the uprising in Crete, were solved in this way. The July crisis of 1914 in itself was not a crisis of a wider importance. It got that importance as the final chapter, that is what I think, in a of a diplomatic strategy that was conceived in order to render the functioning of the diplomatic mechanism of the concert of powers in the Balkans obsolete. So the idea is July crisis is impossible to solve because in Austria-Hungary there were some diplomats and generals that thought that for the Balkan matters that concerned Austria-Hungary, the Council of European Powers should not be concerned. If I am called to analyze the strategy that I'm imagining, is Austro-Hungarian diplomats always presented the Balkan issues as a clear-cut case of bilateral problem between Austria-Hungary and a weaker Balkan state. That is the way of avoiding, of convoking of an international conference to solve the issue. When you have that bilateral perspective, in the end, it ended with the use of ultimatums and the use and the threat of the use of force. The best known example that inaugurated this kind of policy is the case of the annexation of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Let me talk you through the main elements of the crisis. Bilateral perspective, first, as we all know, the meeting with Izvolsky at Buchlau, then the negotiations with Ottoman Empire in order to settle the issue by paying a lump sum of money. And during all that time, the demands for an international conference to settle the issue were put aside. And finally, as we all know, there was a confrontation between Serbia and Russia that was solved by the threat of German mobilization. But let us not forget that what Austria-Hungary did was a unilateral decision in a breach of a valid international treaty, which in itself inaugurated a new way of settling international crises that undermined, if not overruled, the concert of powers and deposed what I call a power diplomacy in the Balkans. Well, introduced by Ballhausplatz, the pattern of unilateral actions was followed also by a regional alliance during the Balkan Wars. Well, what are the Balkan Wars? The Balkan Wars is a sort of a miracle for the 1912 Europe. A 100-year-old empire went down in only a few weeks. And what is even more important, the Balkan, small Balkan state established their frontiers to their liking before the European powers could even react. All the European powers could do is to codify the result of the war during the conference of ambassadors in London starting in December 1912. And the only modification to the situation on the ground they made is to create an Albanian state. Well, as we all know, this was the wish and the desire of the Central Powers, and the objective is to prevent Serbia to establish a foothold on the Adriatic shore. Well, let us go back and consider Ottoman Empire as what it used to be, a vital element of the Europe balance of powers. So, its demise proved to that the existing mechanism of international relations was inoperative. Why? Because, once again, because of an unilateral action. It seemed as if the concert of powers was capable of solving only colonial issues, but in Europe, where national interests were at stake, only the power diplomacy counted. The Second Balkan War gave additional credibility to such a hypothesis. The way in which the Balkan allies fought between themselves demonstrated that the concert of European powers were incapable of imposing and maintaining peace in the region. Well, if we look into these two types of unilateral actions, may I add that there was a huge difference between a purely regional conflict and the conflict that involved a great power as Austria-Hungary was. The regional conflicts and alliances could not endanger the balance of power because of their proverbial volatility. Balkan alliance it was at first sponsored by Russia, but after the Second Balkan War, Bulgaria changed sides and became de facto an ally of Austria-Hungary. On the other hand, Romania, which was former ally of Austria-Hungary after the Second Balkan War and the annexation of Dobruja, became untrustworthy and since its main enemy in the Balkans henceforth was Bulgaria. Direct involvement of a great power such as Austria-Hungary gave a wider importance to Balkan issues. For example, in May of 1913, there was the issue of the town of Skadar, and the Austria-Hungary decided to force Montenegrins out of Skadar. But since it was an unilateral action, all other powers of Europe were obliged to send their ships in order to give to that action a sort of a multipolar and national action. Once again, Austria-Hungary used ultimatum in October 1913 when an ultimatum was issued to Serbia, which had operated an incursion on Albanian territory. So, following the same pattern, we can see in a different light also the July 1914. Well, we all know what was the decision-making process. First, the decision to go to war reached in a conversation between Berthold and Emperor Franz Joseph, and afterwards the Hoyos mission in Berlin, and finally, two meetings in Vienna when it was decided to issue an ultimatum to Serbia, an ultimatum that it could never accept. This brief analysis of the difficult moments in the history of the Balkans from 1908 to 1914 brings us, to my mind, to a conclusion that Austro-Hungarian diplomacy, and even its generals, consider the situation in Balkans of utmost importance for the survival of the dual monarchy. During each crisis, the Vienna consulted Berlin, the German alliance was even tested, and different projects of partition of Serbia and the Balkans were conceived. We should remember all of these projects written by the chief of Austro-Hungarian staff, Conrad von Hetzendorf. One has the impression that Austro-Hungarian diplomats and generals were convinced that any compromise in the Balkans would inexorably lead to the demise of the Habsburg monarchy. Since German backing, sometimes more, sometimes less willingly, was forthcoming, Austro-Hungarian elites followed exclusively power diplomacy in the Balkans. The victory, diplomatic or a military one, in whatever shape or form, was an imperative for Vienna. For example, let us remember the Lehman-Sanders affair of end of 1913. That was the moment that even Germans accepted a compromise in the Balkans. Well, the Austro-Hungarians refused to do so. And we should, it is well known, that in each of these crises in Vienna, they were ready to consider the possibility of a war and even a continental one. On the other hand, let us underline that, as we have already heard, no Balkan issue was considered to justify a continental war for the Entente. On numerous occasions, either French or British, let it be known to the Russian government that they will not go to war over Balkan issues. That was the case during the annexation of Bosnia. That was the case at the beginning of the London Conference of Ambassadors. That was the case at the beginning of the Balkan Wars. Perhaps Poincaré did bring a change in the overall orientation of the French foreign policy, but one should not forget that Poincaré did not really know what was the content of the Balkan Alliance until summer of 1912. And when he heard that it was an offensive alliance, what he did is to try to find a way in order to prevent the war from starting. So, how was it possible that Austria-Hungary was in mortal danger if you know that during the years from 1908 to 1914, Serbia was her principal adversary in the Balkans? As we all know, even after the Balkan War, Serbia was a small, underdeveloped country, exhausted by two wars, having great difficulties in establishing a functional administration in its new territories. Even if we consider the contacts Serbia had with its co-nationals in Austria-Hungary, whose anti-constitutional character Austria-Hungary tried to demonstrate during the Zagreb and Findung process, we can't really say that in those years there was a South Slav revolution on foot in the Balkans. Well, the existence of what's usually called the Croat-Serbian coalition in Croatia, or the existence of Serbian parties in Bosnia and Herzegovina and in Vojvodina, could not be seriously considered as a major threat to the survival of Austria-Hungary, because the main Croat and Slovene political parties consisted of law-abiding and God-fearing subjects of His Catholic Majesty Francis Joseph. From the Balkan War onwards, we should know that the few democratic institutions that existed in these provinces were neutralized by exceptional measures put in place by Vienna. So, where was the problem? Should we speak about series of attempts on the lives of the local governors that took place in those years? To my mind, it was a demonstration of amateurism of both the perpetrators and the local police. Should we go to the events of Sarajevo of 1914? I sincerely do not consider that the events of Sarajevo can be seen as a demonstration of a revolutionary atmosphere, nor, for that matter, of the excellent marksmanship of Gavrilo Princip. I would say that it was the demonstration of a rather small importance that Austro-Hungarian authorities in Bosnia and Herzegovina paid to the visit of Franz Ferdinand. One should remember that for Emperor's visit 2 years back, soldiers were placed shoulder to shoulder thick on the, along the route of the Emperor's cavalcade. Why then did Count Arenthal and his disciples such as Count Hoyos, Count Forgach or Baron Mussolin, all of those played important roles in summer of 1914, share the same belief that Austria-Hungary is in what's called mortal danger. What they spoke about, and we just heard the idea of the importance of not losing the status of great power. Perhaps answer lies in their concept of Habsburg monarchy. They were all aristocrats of different national origins, whose allegiance went primarily to the emperor and the idea of monarchy he incarnated. They were more than unhappy with the international structure of the monarchy, the personal union, the interminable discussion of the negotiation that went on between Austrian and Hungarian part of the common strait. What they feared most is the setback in the Balkans could endanger the prestige of the monarchy, and in the end, the Austria-Hungary would lose the status of great power. Perhaps they were incapable of reforming the international structure of the monarchy to their liking. And that is why they accepted this sort of a hazardous foreign policy. Even more, they were convinced that a firm and resolute foreign policy in the Balkans could strengthen the monarchy and gave it new force and new hopes. They were aware, as I already said, that such a hazardous policy could lead to an European war and the destruction of the fragile internal structure of the European Union. Oh, sorry. That's not a...
Freudian mistake. Freudian mistake.
Of Austria-Hungary. But they accepted the risk. What they said, if I'm allowed to make a simplification, is it would be better to go down fighting than to succumb to the new and vigorous forces without a fight. What were those forces that were fighting, that they were fighting inside and outside of the monarchy? They were fighting against a concept of a nation state that destroyed so easily the Ottoman Empire and threatened to be the main force in the decomposition of the Austria-Hungary. In their view, Serbia was the perfect example of a small, impertinent, and aggressive national state that set a bad example both for the national communities inside Austria-Hungary and threatened its prestige in Balkans and in Europe. Victory over Serbia, that in their project meant its occupation or its division with Bulgaria, might in a way set the clock back and halt the omnipresent advance of the national principle. How then did Serbia qualify for such a dubious privilege of being the principal rivalry in the Balkans of the multi-secular Habsburg monarchy? The obvious answer is because of its strong national action. But was Serbian national action that successful and that coherent as it sometimes presented? The Ilija Garašanin is Načertanje, and its long-term aims tend to hide the fact that on the battlefield Serbia had few successes. To cut a long story short, from Miloš Obrenović onwards, the territorial expansion was due mainly to diplomatic excellence, since, for example, the wars of 1976-78 or the war of 1985, Serbia lost. After those wars, Serbia, but we should underline, as Austro-Hungarian client state with Austro-Hungarian benediction, conceived the strategy of cultural and religious expansion in the neighboring Ottoman provinces. Therefore, Serbia, as a sort of Austro-Hungarian advance party, commenced its fight that, in the end, ended with the victory in the Balkan Wars. But when did actually Serbia lost Austro-Hungarian's backing? I would say when its government started improving its relations with St. Petersburg, or to put it bluntly, when Serbia ceased to be an exclusively Austro-Hungarian client state. The change was not due to the cloak and dagger scenario of the coup d'etat of 1903, but came with the departure of the staunchest defender of Austria-Hungary's alliance in Serbia, King Milan Obrenović. It should be said also that King Alexander Obrenović and his wife Draga Mašin were not killed because Apis and his friends wanted to change Serbia's foreign policy. They were killed because their marriage was an insult to the values of the traditional Serbian society, which the officers were called upon to defend. Let us remember that the national action in which they excelled afterwards came as a sort of an afterthought. And also, before they staged the coup of 1903, they even called the King Milan to come back and to restore order in Serbia, and in that matter, they restored the Philo-Austrian orientation of the Serbia's foreign policy. On the other hand, the radical governments headed mostly by Nikola Pašić were the real architects of a new independent Serbia, which fought for political and economic freedom against the omnipresent double monarchy. The customs war with Austria-Hungary has been recently presented as a futile exercise motivated exclusively by misconceived conception of Serbia's national interests. The alternative, one could imagine, should have been the continued inexorable economic expansion and the successful process of state building under the benevolent and protective wing of the dual monarchy. The improbability of such a scenario that has a strong colonial scent to it is beyond demonstration. The history is often more easily understood when placed in a regional and historic context. It seems quite difficult to find an example of a nation state in the Balkans that followed the aforementioned scenario. On the contrary, as a rule, the Balkan national states conceived first and foremost their project of a territorial expansion based on rather extensively imagined areas populated by respective co-nationals under foreign domination. Therefore, Garašin's Nacertanje, Greek Megali there, were realized, albeit only incompletely, by the creation of Great Serbia, Great Bulgaria, and Great Greece. A lot of pages have been written on the unacceptably nationalistic concept of Great Serbia. The evident and abusive use of hindsight, due mainly to the study of the Serbia's history in the light of the events of 1990s, is not the only methodological problem of a such analysis, since it does not take into account the action of Serbia's allies in the Balkan Wars. For example, Great Greece of the end of 1912 boasted the conquest of the hometown of Kemal Pasha Atatürk, Salonika, and in the same time Great Bulgaria had access on both Aegean and Black Sea. As for the national homogeneity of both states, let us remember the exchange of population with Greece and Turkey and the exodus of Turks from Bulgaria in the second part of the 20th century. Why was then Serbia the only culprit of the Balkan nationalism? For the simple reason that her national and territorial expansion, be it in Albania or in Macedonia, isolated Austria-Hungary from the rest of the Balkans. Since in all other directions, Austria-Hungary expansion has already been halted by powerful neighbors, it was inconceivable that it should also be the case in the Balkans because of Serbia. Therefore, it seems, perhaps it's an exaggeration, that only Serbia that was acceptable for Austria-Hungary was Serbia as a client state. A sort of advanced party in Austro-Hungarian expansion in the Balkans, as Serbia used to be during the reign of Milan Obrenović. Pašić Serbia, that protested against the annexation of Bosnia-Herzegovina, that won the Battle of Kumano and advanced as far as Albanian shores, and moreover had the impertinence to maintain contacts with its co-nationals in Austria-Hungary was an insult to the Habsburg prestige and a bad example for its subjects harboring nationalistic programs. I would suggest that the Sarajevo events came as a final confirmation of the impossibility to impose Austria-Hungarian influence in Serbia and to put its foreign policy under control. What I spoke at the beginning, power diplomacy, Austro-Hungarian prestige, and even in the analysis of Austro-Hungarian diplomats and generals, the survival of Habsburg Empire was at stake, and therefore it was inconceivable for Forgács, Hojos, Muslin, or Konrad von Hetzendorf that Serbia could get away with such a problem without being crushed completely. Therefore, the diplomatic scenario established in 1908 was put in action, first by a German carte blanche, then an ultimatum to prevent any possibility of external mediation was put in place, and finally war was used as the ultimate measure to strengthen the prestige of Habsburg monarchy. I may have another page, but I've been told that someone else could take the floor.
Now, Professor Naruchnitska has asked to speak from the floor, and I know Dr. Batakovic does, so I suggest we take at least these two questions because we are a bit short of time, please.
My great thanks for the invitation for this great conference. Great, I mean, because after I heard the initial statements, I was very glad that I came because they were dealing with panorama view, trying to summarize and perceive the results, the researches with regard to the First World War, which are a good, and must be a good lesson to us. I'm very glad, I'm very grateful to the key person of our conference, Mr. Vuk, Minister, Mr. Vuk Jeremic, because he mentioned the lessons, although maybe he didn't use that word. Among the aspects of the First World War, as lessons, we might dwell not only on the national egoistic interests which lead in the 20th century to such cataclysms that change not only the defeated enemy, but change completely even the victorious countries, which makes it impossible even to achieve anything planned at the beginning of the war. And that is the new feature of world cataclysms, first produced for us by the First World War. But also the role of ideological aspects, which today play the media, but at the time of the First World War, it were the numerous universalist transnational units like Marxist, Liberatorist, Freemason, other anti-clerical, anti-Christian. If you read their texts preceding the First World War, you understand that they were much less sympathetic with the interest of their respective countries, ready to sacrifice them or even to achieve defeat. But then in the achievement of some one-dimensional world built on the same criteria for everyone, etc. So now we compare it with this almost Trotskyite theory of world liberal revolution to establish democracy in Libya, in Egypt, etc. Ernst Nolte, the enfant terrible of German political science, was not wholly was quite right when he said that the defeat and the crush of traditional societies of all European countries as a result of the First World War produced many of the fascist ideas in very different parts of Europe, which was not incidental. And without Giolitti, the Italian leader who praised the crush of old regimes, traditionalist, based on Christian values, without Giolitti, without his naive praising of such developments, there wouldn't be success of Mussolini. So it's also one of the lessons of the First World War. As far as Fritz Fischer's books, I'm so glad because I quoted them many times in my books. One of them is translated already in 5 European languages without any promotional effort on my part. Mr. Professor Christopher Clark's conclusion that, of course, you can't blame totally Germany, although the decision of the committee to establish the responsibility for war on Versailles Conference clearly stated that it was Austria-Hungary and Germany, because many countries, it was very dangerous. It's also a lesson for us that at such cataclysm, world wars stop being a way to realize their initial national interest, because they change the whole world afterwards, absolutely. And the victorious countries come to the end in such turmoils, like Russia was crushed, etc. And also the defeated countries not only lose what they plan to gain anew, but they lose even the previous assets, which were never disputed before by any rivals. So that happened to Austria-Hungary and Kaiser Germany in the First World War, and the same, in later events too. So that is a lesson for us also. And the first, the Russian envoy in Paris, even in already in 1986, I think, Morenheim wrote a letter to the central body in St. Petersburg saying that in the possible future war, France and Britain would be allies. That shocked, because it's after 300 years of rivalry between France and Britain, that was a very new development produced by the growth of new Bismarckian Germany, etc., etc. And of course, we now witness the modern epoch after the collapse of Soviet Union revealed so many of old aspects and aspirations that déjà vu, not to speak of Eastern question, the rivalry over the Caspian, Black Sea and Mediterranean, with the same concerns of great powers of with whom Serbia and Balkan countries after collapse of the Soviet Union and communist ideology will join, thus changing the balance of power in Europe again and again. And that is a great lesson to us, because it is within this paradigm that I would like us to research now the lesson, the aspects, the events of the First World War, because it is a great prism to understand also today's developments, reinforced by the economic importance of the same regions that caused and were the object of international conflict since time immemorial, since Hannibal and Rome Empire. Thank you very much. And
I was very happy to listen to these distinguished historians, and it's very important for us in Belgrade to have such an overview in such a competent way. I'm also grateful to Mr. Jeremic for everything he has done. This is a real success already. I hope we won't spoil it in the afternoon or tomorrow. However, I had a few questions which I think will be interesting for the public, as they are interesting for myself. I would like to take Professor Pogge von Strandmann for this very convincing expose on Germany's responsibility, and I think that himself and Professor John Roll are right when they said that there is a solar system and the Germany is sun. I would only add, if I may, Professor, that Austria-Hungary is the main satellite. Austria-Hungary seems somehow remained invisible, apart from Mr. Pavlović's speech that the responsibility of Austria-Hungary should be also reconsidered. Yes, it has its more Balkan component than its worldwide, as Germany did. But without Austria-Hungary, you know, Germany would probably be less powerful in her grief nach der Weltmacht. I would also like to thank to Professor Clark, to whom I promise I will be very polite today. We discussed already these issues previous year in Munich in a very nice conference organized by historische Kolleg. And I fully agree with you that Russia, as the recent writings are telling us, is not responsible for the war. I remember 20 years ago, I had a lunch with Professor Samuel Williamson here in Belgrade, and we discussed more about the Black Hand and the Serbia's role than about responsibility for the war. But when I asked him, why does he blame Russia, he said they mobilized first. I said, yes, they mobilized first because they have 11-hour zones. They don't have railways, and it was only a warning, and it was only a partial mobilization. Therefore, Russia's responsibility is out of question. Being a student of Georges-Henri Soutou, who was director of my thesis at the Sorbonne, I'm also aware that some French politicians thought that they were drawn into the war by Russia and the Russian interest in the Balkans. But in any way, I think it's deniable that Germany responsibility stays as it was confirmed by Fritz Fischer and his students. I've read many books in the meantime, including the latest one by Jeffrey Wavro on the Austro-Hungarian origins of the war, and it still confirms the theses which were already in the 60s expressed in the books by Professor Fritz Fischer. And as far as Lieven mission in Serbia is concerned, I only want to say to Professor Lieven and to thank him for his contribution that what your family history says is totally true. I've read the Serbian sources. Thank you so much.
Now I think we are running of time and we... Please do.
You want me to say something?
No, I thought you wanted to.
Look, I've already talked. I'd much rather let someone out there who's desperate to ask something. I'm happy to leave. All I would, I suppose, say is that it seems to me that Austrian rulers regard Serbia as a great power, views a minnow power, as Germans look at Slavs, as aristocrats look at what they think of as peasants, and after 1913 as what embodiments of the so-called civilized world think of so-called barbarians. That entirely sums up the attitude of European imperialists around the world towards their smaller, less powerful, less developed neighbors. It seems to me that you have to ask what's different. And what is different is perfectly simple. It's geopolitics. That you can get away with things outside Europe, particularly if you monopolize sea power, in a way that you can't within Europe. And the reason you can't in the Austrian case is summed up in one word. It's called Russia. For various reasons, Russia is not prepared to allow Austria to carry out what is essentially an imperialist policy, both for geopolitical reasons and because whereas for all their rivalries, the European powers outside Europe agree on a common contempt for the native, when you apply that to the Slavs of the Balkans, inevitably you set off Russian sensitivities because the Russians are aware that they also are Slavs and that the contempt is to some extent directed towards them as well. And on that point, I would, I think, just stop.
Yeah. I think we've overstepped time anyway for about 10 minutes, so I think we should.
Should we say something still? Or?
I mean, if there's something in particular you want to say, yes, of course.
Well, just very briefly want to say that the Kaiser in 1905 said the future powers of the world are the United States, Great Britain, and Russia. And Germany is too small to be one of the world powers. We have to let our base grow so that Germany could become the fourth of the world powers of the future. And the way to do it at that time was thought through war and military means. And the interesting thing is the German industrialists, there were already some who thought this was totally unnecessary. Rathenau and Stinnes both believed that Germany would become an empire through economic means and doesn't need a war. But Germany was set up by military people, and the military couldn't think about anything else about territory and wars and conquest. Completely different from indirect rule through economists. But the fact that the two said it means that the climate in Germany was for military means rather than for economic ones. Thank you.
Professor Pavlović, please.
Thank you very much. I'll just respond very, very briefly to two points that Dusan Bartakovic made. I mean, I'm a great admirer of your work, and you're an extremely exciting and insightful writer, also a very interesting historian to read. Just two points. You make the point that the Russians had to mobilize first because it took them longer. I remember I was told that by my teachers at school, and I remember I was thinking, if you're in the United States, in a country where the police have guns, and you pull your gun and you get shot, and then in court, you say to the judge, "I had to pull my gun first because he pulls his faster." That would not be a very good argument. So I think the decision to mobilize is still a very important decision. It doesn't amount to Russian responsibility, but it's an escalating decision. It's one of a long chain of escalating decisions. It doesn't mean we put the Russians in the frame. The other question here, just about putting Germany. Saying that, you know, your comment that we're still where Fischer was in the 1960s, Germany is still the sun in the solar system. I would say that we should just remember that when we argue that way now in a contemporary context, those are the arguments which we, if you apply it to the Ukrainian crisis today, the Fischer-style argument is to say Putin is destroying world peace, right? Putin is Adolf Hitler, right? That is the way to apply Fischer to the Ukrainian crisis today. To think about it in a more differentiated way would mean acknowledging that there are all kinds of different agency caught up in the Ukrainian crisis, turbulence within the Ukraine itself, the EU's Eastern Neighborhood policy, the interests of NATO and the EU, and so on. So that, you know, in other words, what I'm pleading for is simply the complexity of the crisis of 1914. And that's where Fischer falls short, in acknowledging that complexity. But thank you very much for your comments.